Good evening. Good evening and welcome. I'm David Oxtoby, President of the Academy, and it's my pleasure to call to order the 2080th meeting, stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Today, the Academy's Council, Trust, and Board met for their semi-annual meetings. I want to thank all the members of our governance boards, and in particular to express my gratitude to our Treasurer, Carl Fortzheimer, our Secretary, Jerry Richmond, Vice Chairs Diane Wood and Alan Dax, and the Chair of our Board, Nancy Andrews. Thank you for your advice, your leadership, and your caring for this Academy. Please join me in acknowledging their service. The centerpiece of our spring governance meetings is the election of our new class of fellows, which is scheduled for tomorrow. The election concludes an 18-month process involving 28 membership panels and over 200 fellows. We will announce the class of 2019 on the morning of next Wednesday, April 17. At that time, we hope you will reach out to welcome our new fellows into the life of the Academy. The election of new members again strengthens the Academy's ability to achieve our mission of convening leaders from every field of human endeavor to examine new ideas, address issues of importance to the nation and the world, and work together to cultivate every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. Those are words from the original establishment of the Academy. By honoring the extraordinary achievements in every field and discipline, the Academy upholds ideals of research and scholarship, creativity and imagination, intellectual exchange and civil discourse, the pursuit of knowledge in all its forms, and the application of research to policy. It has done so for 238 years and will do so again this evening as we present awards to 8 distinguished individuals. Academy Prize selections are overseen by a committee chaired with great care by Pauline Yu, President of the American Council of Learned Societies and a member of our board. The committee solicited nominations from Academy Fellows, compiled lists of candidates, sent them out for appraisal by other Academy Fellows. We're grateful to everyone who participated in this process. Please join me in thanking the prize committee, several of whom are with us this evening. Pauline Yu, Nancy Andrews, Diane Wood, Jerry Richmond, Reed Hasty, Scott Sanders, and Lucia Rothman Dennis. Thank you much. The Academy offers 8 major prizes and awards: the Sarton Prize for Poetry, the Sarton Prize for History of Science, the Talcott Parsons Prize for Social Science, the Emerson Thoreau Medal for Literature, the Francis Amory Prize in Reproductive Medicine and Physiology, the Don M. Randall Award for Humanistic Studies, and tonight's award, a new inaugural award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs, and then also tonight, the Rumford Prize for Physical Sciences. So to say a few words about the second prize, the Rumford Prize, it's one of the oldest scientific prizes in the United States, established in 1839 and sustained by a generous endowment given to the Academy in 1876 by Benjamin Thompson, Count Rumford. The Rumford Prize for Physical Science recognizes achievement in the area of heat and light, broadly construed. This year we will honor 6 recipients: Ernst Bamberg, Edward Boyden, Karl Deisseroth, Peter Hegemann, Gero Miesenbach, and Georg Nagel for their contributions to optogenetics. Professor Edward Boyden will be accepting the award on behalf of the group and will be introduced later this evening by Professor Lucia Rothman Dennis. But first, tonight, we recognize the winner of our inaugural award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs, recognizing Ernest Moniz, the 13th United States Secretary of Energy. Though tonight marks the first time we've given a formal award for leadership in public affairs, such a commitment to public affairs has driven the Academy's work from its beginnings. The leading scholars of the newly independent United States established the Academy in 1780 to guide the leaders of the young republic through the turbulent times ahead. The first 3 American presidents were members of the Academy, including one of our founders, John Adams. Other early members included leaders of the American Revolution, signers of the Declaration of Independence, delegates to the Constitutional Convention. We've been honored to count among our members such statesmen as Winston Churchill and Nelson Mandela. Our members continue that tradition of public service, including several who are with us tonight, such as Governor Phil Bredesen, Chief Judge Diane Wood, and the presenter of tonight's first award, Secretary Ash Carter. Ash Carter is the director of the Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs at Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government. At Harvard Kennedy School, he leads the Technology and Public Purpose Project and serves as the Belfer Professor of Technology and Global Affairs. He's also an Innovation Fellow and member of the Corporation of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Prior to his time at Harvard, he served as the 25th United States Secretary of Defense from 2015 to 17 in the same cabinet as Secretary Moniz under President Obama. Secretary Carter worked for 35 years under presidents of both parties, earning the Defense Distinguished Service Medal 5 times for his service. Please welcome Ash Carter, who will introduce you to our inaugural Award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs recipient. Secretary Carter.
Thank you all. And President Oxtoby, thank you. Chairman Andrews, thank you for having me here today. Naomi, good to see you. This is a wonderful opportunity for me to honor Ernest Moniz and also to reconnect with the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. I have a lot of warm feeling for this place. Did a lot of work here over many years and wrote the better part of 2 books here on these very premises. So it's very nice to be back here, and I appreciate your grace in inviting me to come, but especially to honor my friend and, as you said, fellow cabinet member, but longtime colleague, Ernie Moniz. Ernie and I have intersected in so many ways, as President Oxtoby noted, both physicists, have gone in and out of government over the course of our lives. For Ernie, that means he was Undersecretary of Energy back in the 1990s, a very senior and important position at an early time in his career. He also served in the President's Office of Science and Technology Policy, high-level advisory positions in the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, and also the Threat Reduction Advisory Council of the Department of Defense. And of course, at MIT, as the director of the Bates Linac, which did meson nuclear interactions, head of physics, the founding director of the MIT Energy Initiative, and I'm pleased to say today, in addition to his positions at MIT, is associated with the Belfer Center, which I'm the director of. He's well known for his work on nuclear power, carbon sequestration, other low carbon approaches to energy, and for many, many other things, as well as to his contributions for fundamental knowledge. But here tonight, I want to particularly talk about his contributions as Secretary of Energy to President Obama and therefore my colleague in the cabinet. And I can't cover all he did as Secretary of Energy. There's just so much. I picked a few examples, and they're mostly areas where his responsibilities and my responsibilities overlapped, and where therefore I had the privilege of observing firsthand what Ernie was doing. And I was very grateful to have him as my colleague all the time. You know, you may think that all conversation in the Situation Room is well-informed and edifying. You'd be disappointed. And as I looked around that table looking for good sense, as I observed a president genuinely wrestling with a serious problem, and I looked to someone I could count on to be not only deep in the information sense, but preternaturally articulate, persuasive when he needed to be, and just sensible. And who also had that wonderful characteristic that is somewhere in our founding documents, as a country, which bids us to have a reasonable respect for the opinions of mankind, which invites us to be larger than ourselves as a country, which isn't a bad thing to have in mind when you're advising the President of the United States either. And Ernie always had those things. You may not know all the ways that a Secretary of Defense and a Secretary of Energy work together, but just to give you a few of the examples of the things that Ernie did, I, of course, depended upon him for what is the bedrock of our security as far into the future as I can see, and despite the fact that collectively they pose to humankind a grave and existential danger, and that is to preserve the nuclear arsenal of the United States. That meant recapitalizing the nuclear triad, which we haven't done in 25 years and is well past time to do, keeping our stockpiles safe, secure, and reliable without a resumption of underground testing, which is not a trivial matter or something you just wish away, and watching after nuclear control both in this country and everywhere around the world. Those are all areas where Ernie and I worked together, and it was necessary that we worked collaboratively because the stakes were extremely large. You may not know that the Department of Energy is also the second largest R&D enterprise in the federal government. Before I was Secretary of Defense, I was the number two, the COO of the department for a number of years, the chief operating officer, and before that, the chief technology and weapons and R&D person, the number three in the department. And so during all those times, I had managerial responsibilities. I was grateful for the laboratories of DOE, Livermore, Los Alamos, Sandia, and there are others. And you all know the work they do on nuclear weapons, but be multidisciplinary, very capable laboratories with a personnel system that makes it easier for them to attract and retain talent than is true for a normal government intramural laboratory, for example, which we operate a number of. The quality was pretty high, and therefore I depended upon them for things far afield from nuclear weapons, a number of sensitive activities for which we needed the best of the best, and I was able to get that in a sensitive environment, a classified environment out of the Department of Energy laboratories, very important. Naval reactors, we have submarines, both attack submarines and missile submarines with nuclear reactors in them, and also aircraft carriers with nuclear reactors, and it's important, as it is in any deployment of nuclear power, that it be done in a safe way, and Ernie's a great expert in that, not only for marine, but by the way, for terrestrial nuclear power plants as well, and so I knew I could trust him to help us in that area. Energy more broadly isn't first and foremost a mission of the Department of Defense, but I believed under Ernie Moniz in that we as another mission agency of the federal government owed him a role in his energy strategy for the country as a whole. Ernie put that together, the president approved it, it had many different prongs, and my attitude was, Ernie, you run the energy policy of the country, I run the defense of the country, but you tell me what my part is, and I'll try to play it. It has to be consistent with defending ourselves in one way or another, but I'm prepared to defend the proposition that even though a particular role might not be directly and provably deployable in defense in the future, that on the strength of Ernie's recommendation, I was prepared to defend an investment as one of the bets the country ought to make, and somebody had to make it, and he said it was my turn on that one, and so I would do it. That was a baton I was willing to take and run with, and did. In some areas, I had a need that was well in front of the market, and I had to satisfy that need. I'll give you an example, which is lightweight batteries, which is kind of a holy grail, lightweight, long lifetime batteries. And consider infantrymen in Helmand province. Okay, spent a long time there, over many years. I've been there lots and lots and lots and lots, and it's 120 degrees in the shade, lots and lots and lots and lots there. And we sent people out on patrol. And today's soldier or Marine, intended to be in these two cases, carries not only a weapon and food and water and so forth, but a whole bunch of electronic equipment, communications, intelligence, navigation, all of which they sensibly wish to have backup batteries for. And you end up sending someone out with a equal weight of batteries to the weight of electronic equipment they have. And if I could get that down some, I was willing to pay quite a bit. That's just an example of a place where I was pretty cost insensitive. Anything you could do to lighten the energy load on an individual soldier, I'd pay a lot for that, much more than you'd pay to have a spare battery for your flashlight when you go camping. But if you think about that as in the pipeline of the advancement of a technology, what that means is that there's a customer that is willing to be an early adopter and help the technology get down the learning curve. And that was another place through Ernie's eARPA, which is his version of DARPA. DARPA was a great thing, it's been great for the Department of Defense, great for the country overall. Ernie had something called eARPA, which meant to do the same thing in his mission area. And so I believe that I played a role there also in the national energy strategy as an early adopter in some of those areas. And again, I took my steer from Ernie in those areas. And so we worked together very closely. And last thing I want to say that I appreciated, just again, I'm just giving you examples here of many, many things Ernie did, and that happens to be the ones I saw, was the Iran nuclear deal. When President Obama asked me to come back to Washington and become Secretary of Defense, one of the things he said to me is, he said, hey, Ash, would you keep, I know you're a physicist, would you keep your eye on that Iran nuclear deal? And I said, Mr. President, I can do that if you wish, but I need to tell you that I don't think I need to, because you have Ernie Moniz doing that. And I think I have complete confidence in him as Secretary of Defense that whatever he does is going to be buttoned down. And I think you can have that confidence too, and I think you're just using two of your people, on one puck here, and you ought to, how's about I go off and do some other things that are important, and you leave the nuclear deal to Ernie? And he said, okay, and I did. I paid no attention to it. I didn't. And it wasn't that I wasn't interested, and it wasn't that I wasn't dependent upon the outcome of it. It was that Ernie Moniz was taking care of it, and I thought it was okay, and I had plenty to do. And I needed to be in every meeting, and the president had an important moment, he'd call us all together, and it was one of the few times when I didn't say a whole lot in the sit room, because I didn't need to. But there was one consequence of it, and which led to its ultimate unraveling, which was this. And I'll just tell you the story. The morning after the deal was concluded, I sat down, as I always did, with the then chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Marty Dempsey, and he and I would sit down at a little round table in my office every morning and kind of say to one another, well, what do we do now? You know, what do we do today? And so this deal had come down, and Ernie said, sir, well, you know, what are your instructions to the department for what to do in lieu of the conclusion of the Iran nuclear deal? And I said, don't change anything. Keep 28,500 in the Gulf, freedom of navigation in the Gulf, preserve and continue to polish our ability to destroy Iran's nuclear program if they change course, which we have and retained, and Ernie's people helped quite a bit with. And continue to support our friends and allies in the Gulf, including especially Israel, and continue to stand strong against all Iran's malign activities around the Gulf and worldwide. And all that we were doing before and all that we need to continue to do. What Ernie has done in that agreement is take a big headache away from me for the future. And that was the possibility that to everything else, all the other headaches I had with Iran, I had to add nuclear weapons. And he provably, in a completely watertight way, made that something that wouldn't happen or that we would see with plenty of time for me to react. And that was a big, big load off my mind. Now, for the population as a whole, that was a hard thing to understand. People don't understand when you negotiate with people that you don't, basically don't like. They don't get that. And they didn't understand that this was not and could never have been a grand bargain with Iran. And so that laid something which made perfect sense within its own frame, open to being politically criticized, that as frequently happens in presidential transitions, thrown overboard. For my money, that, you know, we'll pick ourselves up and move on, but for me as Secretary of Defense, that meant just more forces to deter and more defenses to defend and things that I would prefer not to have had to do. So for this and so for so much more, I, as Secretary of Defense, conferred upon Ernie Moniz the Defense Distinguished Service Medal, which is the highest award that can be given by the Department of Defense to a Secretary of Energy because of what he had done for our national defense. And I'll bet you I could say about everybody else in the cabinet and every other function, let alone what the president could say, their indebtedness to him. All this is a very proud legacy for Ernie Moniz. There's more to come. He may want to talk about it in his acceptance. He's involved in nuclear security, biosecurity at the Nuclear Threat Initiative, which he runs. He has something called the Green Real Deal he's talking about these days, which I like the, I don't know exactly what's in it, but it sounds, has a good name. And the American Academy, too, has seen fit to honor Ernest with this inaugural award, and I can't think of anyone better. And it's my honor now to read the citation on this, the very first occasion of the awarding of the Award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs to Ernest Moniz. And so, yeah, if we can have David and Nancy and Ernest come up, please. And, you know, normally I'd say attention to orders, but I can't do that here, I realize. The American Academy of Arts and Sciences was founded by a group of patriots who devoted their lives to, and I quote, cultivating every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. The Award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs is presented to individuals for the distinction, independence, effectiveness, and work on behalf of the common good. For his exceptional record of serving the public interest, championing ideals, principles, and ethics that advance the welfare of the nation and the world, exhibiting courage in the performance of his public service, and working with unusual effectiveness at the highest levels of government, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences hereby confers the inaugural Award for Excellence in Public Policy and Public Affairs on Ernest Moniz. It has been said that the art of communication is the language of leadership. Over the course of your career, you have demonstrated repeatedly this ideal by your extraordinary ability to explain complex subjects such as climate change, alternative energy, nuclear weapons, and biosecurity in a way that is meaningful and comprehensive while also evident and understandable. Most importantly, the respectful and humble manner in which you communicate these matters bridges divides and helps to resolve issues that are crucial to our nation and the world. Guided by data and always refreshingly candid, you combine outstanding intellect with a physicist's optimism in a way that shows your natural warmth and sense of humor. Your reliance on facts and your focus on solutions have shown us how dispassionate but determined technical expertise can contribute decisively to the successful treatment of complicated policy issues and global threats. Producing analytically based proposals for energy policy that attracted bipartisan support, leading an international initiative that placed energy science and technology innovation at the center of the global response to climate change, and helping to negotiate and communicate the historic Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action are just a few examples of your many remarkable accomplishments. Physicist, statesman, academic, and lifelong Red Sox fan, you exemplify the Academy's values of using evidence and knowledge to foster deliberative discourse in advancing the common good. You inspire us with your profound insight, dedication, goodwill, and passion for making the world safer and better for generations to come. That's the citation, Mr. President.
I knew Ash had to get some insult in, and with the current state of play, was the Red Sox fan, I think, was the part. But it still beat the last time he compared me to an Albanian mathematician, which I've still not understood. But anyway, Chairman Andrews, thank you very much, and President Oxtoby, and I'm certainly, I really very, very honored to get this inaugural award on public policy and public affairs. As the president said, in an organization that has a little bit of a tradition in this area going back nearly a quarter millennium, actually. So it really is quite special. And I do want to add also that with Ash's remarks on the Distinguished Service Medal at the Department of Defense, which I was also very, very honored to get. Although I have to say, by the way, that Ash's rendition of our close work together on so many issues was actually quite accurate. I think there's the Texas Ranger thing about you only need one, but when you had two physicists, it was they were really outnumbered quite a bit. But also what I want to say is, but Ash, for that ceremony, did something I think very, very special and unusual for the DOD. You know, they got a lot of guns, and so, you know, when they give their awards, you go to them. But Ash came to the Department of Energy, which really was the statement that this was a medal for the incredible scientific base that the Department of Energy was providing in the support of DOD and others, and that's something that that our people took to be quite special. So we appreciated that very, very much. Now, my own engagement, really getting into the areas as a simple New England physicist of public affairs and public policy, really started and was pushed by someone also very close to this academy, Herman Feshbach, who was basically my mentor at the Department of Energy, at MIT, excuse me, and of course president of the academy in the 1980s. And the 1980s, 82 to 86, he was the president. That was a period deep in the Cold War, also a period when the architecture of nuclear arms control was starting. And Herman, many in this room know Herman, knew Herman quite well. They also will understand when I say that the way he encouraged my participation in public affairs issues was called threats. He was also head of the Department of Physics and had other positions. He had a very charming way of threatening threatening people. It was a good threat. And in that time, I'll also reemphasize that Herman, in that period of the Cold War and the arms control architectures, was a major not only proponent of but doer of real dialogue, real interactions with the Soviet Union at that time, great supporter of refuseniks and Sakharov, et cetera. But he was a person who was dedicated to the dialogue, the scientific exchange, exchanges more broadly, as absolutely fundamental to what I would call today risk reduction in terms of what was a very, very challenging situation with the Soviet Union, and I will return to that. Now, of course, in terms of having an opportunity to get more deeply engaged in public affairs and public policy, as has already been referred to, clearly my time as Energy Secretary in the second Obama term was a special opportunity. Ash has described a little bit about the Department of Energy. There's a more whimsical description that it is the Department of Weapons and Windmills, Quarks and Quagmires. And so the weapons, I think, has already been referred to. The department is the steward of the nuclear stockpile, but also the lead in many, many aspects of the global nuclear nonproliferation programs, nuclear materials control issues, et cetera, that the U.S. Very importantly leads. The windmills is a reference clearly to the clean energy and the energy responsibilities today, those energy responsibilities being critical to address climate change. The quarks is the reference to the fact that the department is an enormous supporter of basic science, especially in the physical sciences, and in providing many of the large facilities, user facilities so-called, that serve 30,000 scientists in the United States every year. The quagmires is cleaning up the mess of the Cold War, the environmental mess that's been made in many arenas. I would just say that here at the Academy, energy and environment, global affairs, science and technology are all among the major programs here, and it's kind of a map almost to this diverse set of activities at the Department of Energy. But what I want to emphasize is that when you look at all of those missions, and that you look at the way the department exercises its responsibilities in those areas, it is a science agency. It is about science and the application of science and technology to these set of problems that may seem in many ways to be disconnected. I'll just give as one example, since it's the example that Ash talked about in terms of nuclear weapons. In a world without testing, and we have not tested now in over a quarter century, that is a science problem. It's He takes care of the delivery vehicles, the targeting, et cetera. But the Department of Energy is a science agency addressing these important problems. Now, having said that, it gave me certainly a chance to apply at least the scientific manner of thought to important problems, especially in global affairs. And the reason that the opportunity was present, and frankly, the reason why I had a ball there, was because being a cabinet member, being the Secretary of Energy, when a president has among his highest priorities two of your mission areas, the clean energy climate mission and the nuclear security mission broadly, that's a pretty damn good time to be in those kinds of positions. And I'll say on the nuclear security that I won't refer to this later on, but just note that President Obama launched a series of what turned out to be four biannual nuclear security summits, putting rather arcane issues of nuclear material security, et cetera, on the agenda with roughly 50 national leaders in attendance, and really leading to action, which the Department of Energy had much to do with in terms of execution, of really eliminating, for example, nuclear weapons usable materials in many, many countries. So it was a focus area for the president, and again, for me, an enormous opportunity. And then, of course, in addition, the Iran negotiation in the whole nuclear security arena. Again, Graham Allison is here somewhere tonight. There he is, and he's been very, very forward-leaning in terms of advocating the science statesman idea. And certainly, I think the Iran negotiation was a chance to really exercise that opportunity. But I think also it's very interesting that the president at that time, President Obama, did something very, very unusual, which was to literally, in the end, have two cabinet members, the Secretary of State and the Secretary of Energy, as kind of co-negotiators with their counterparts to get something done. And it was kind of a let's get this done attitude, as opposed to kind of worrying about the general protocols and formalities. So the point, and finally, that I really want to make, I should have talked about climate as well. The other thing was, of course, in parallel, was the clean energy climate agenda, the Paris Agreement. But what is less recognized is that while the Paris Agreement, in terms of CO2 emissions reductions, was by definition the last act of the Paris meeting in December of 2015, the first day of the Paris meeting was actually the announcement made by national leaders. And it was something called Mission Innovation, with a capital M and a capital I. And this is where, again, we had at the Department of Energy a chance to really take a leadership role and eventually pull together 20 countries to sign up to a very aggressive commitment on developing the clean energy solutions for climate change. And what I think is kind of notable is that this was a statement that technology innovation in clean energy is at the core of the solutions to climate change. And I think that's a very, very important realization, very important statement. And that was another part, and again, a chance for us to do a little science statesmanship, if you like, going forward. But in moving to conclusion, what I want to say is that if you look at the climate agreement, which looked to make reductions in CO2 emissions essentially voluntarily in the 2030 timeframe, everybody knows that's not a solution to the climate problem. The Iran agreement, and Ash already mentioned this, this was not the grand agreement where every problem we have with Iran was to be solved, as opposed to addressing a very important problem, the nuclear weapons problem, and getting it off the table as a foundation for doing more. And in fact, since Ash said that, and we obviously on the same page, that there could not have been a grand bargain, is a reminder. Just as Paris was a multinational agreement, the agreement with Iran was not just the United States and Iran. We were the leaders, we were the face-to-face negotiators, but we were representing six countries. Ourselves, of course, three in Europe, Germany, France, and the UK, but Russia and China. This was after after Crimea. So we had very, very tough relationship with Russia already, but we could compartment it and take an important step towards a solution. And the point I really want to make is, in both of those cases, the climate negotiation and the Iran negotiation, it was a pragmatic, step-by-step approach. In neither case was this viewed as the end of the line, quite the contrary. It was reaching a very important risk reduction step on the way to what we would do later. Currently, we hear a lot about going big. You may note the progress. There is a misconception often that going big means vision. Step by step needs vision. Because, in my view, a long-range plan is a whole set of short-range plans, but they better aim in the same direction. And that requires a vision to actually get it done and to have it sustained. Unfortunately, right now, in neither of those two cases, are we seeing the next steps being taken, and the result of that is, in fact, being somewhat retrograde. So I'll just end by saying that that's obviously a description of some of what I was doing at the Department of Energy, clearly we haven't stopped in the last 2 years, and I'll just mention in the same spirit, really, of step by step, what we are doing, and what we find is we of course now in the private sector have additional tools actually that we can use. We lose some tools, but we also gain some, and it's very important that we all, I think, keep trying to contribute. So in the climate arena, Ash mentioned Clean Real Deal. It was in Tom Friedman's column yesterday, and it is exactly the same kind of a statement. Magical thinking on the right, like climate denial, and magical thinking on the left, completely scientifically and politically unreasonable, impossible solutions, you should put in the same bin. And the real issue is working hard, rolling up your sleeves, working to get pragmatic solutions that go, in this case, towards lower carbon, and give you the chance of building the political coalitions around low carbon and social equity that we will need to actually make progress. If I turn to the nuclear security arena, in terms of current activities through my that's, by the way, that's being pushed through an organization we formed called the Energy Futures Initiative. And then with the Nuclear Threat Initiative, one of the major focuses we have is going back to Hermann Feshbach. We need dialogue. We have never, never had such a poor level of dialogue right now with Russia. It's not... We don't advocate dialogue, again, because they're friends. It's because they and we have over 90% of the nuclear weapons. And we need to really think about strategic stability in a new age, by the way, driven with new technical issues like cyber risks in the command and control system, et cetera. So what we're saying is we need scientist-to-scientist discussion. We need military-to-military discussion. We need diplomat-to-diplomat discussion. we need to have that web of dialogue that is pitifully absent today, and that paralysis exposes us to the risk of terrible miscalculation escalating from other incidents. So that's a little bit of the view of what we think we can still continue to keep doing, and certainly, and I say this with all honesty, straightforwardness, I think the award, again, I'm very, very honored to receive this award, the inaugural award, and it will give, I think, further inspiration to try to at least take some steps forward on the way to longer-term solutions. Thank you.